Let's begin with the childhood. On reflection, I remember that in those days, the moment you start losing your milk teeth at around 8 years, you start getting recognized as an adult. I too had a similar experience. I was told that the era of the carefree approach to life was over, and I must prepare to take responsibility now. This means that I had to assist elders in farming and go for radhes, bades, and bondes, the traditional system of collective grazing of animals. It also brought certain privileges. Losar the new year means the rare chance to eat rice to your contentment. Festive occasion like Galpam and Skuvar mean that I could drink Cham, the local beer, barley beer. The fact that I had now joined the band of grown-ups mean that I would be asked to lead dance attempt and community gathering during winter. We had an additional task of sitting with Memele, the grandfather, and pick up the stems of Kesar Epi from the point where these were left last winter. I also remember having had the privilege of assuming a role of Nyaopa in singing Nyolu, the marriage song, for my uncles. This was a time when one's mind would be preoccupied with ideas like marrying a girl, assuming a charge of Jinkam, household economy, shifting the parents into Kangbu, a spread household, and so on. At this stage, I had no idea that thanks to my grandpa, I would soon leave my village for Khalsi, a sort of study up class 5 and then for Timisgam, and lay to complete my 10th. Hunt for government job, sing songs, became a playwright and get famous. As I grew up, I saw things changing around me. I was born at Wanla, 13 days period of India's independence. During the year, Pakistani invaders retreated at a time when I was supposed to have a name, inspired by Ladakh victory over invaders. The then Rinpoche Bakula bestowed me with the name MorupNamgyal. I saw free India and free Ladakh growing along with me. I lost my parents at an early age, but my grandparents brought me up with a mix of chashul and chanshul, their sampa soup, along with kesar tales, folk song, and rich Ladakhi proverbs. I could not study beyond 10, but I was able to make a good use of what nature had given me with my voice. Well, it must have been the outcome of certain good deeds of past lives that my voice became instrumental in shaping my present life, as it became the medium of expression for the artist in me. Those who listened to Wanla Boy and vivid his play appreciated and encouraged him for his talent. My song spread out of Ladakh and echoed from the mountains of Himalayas. My dull life transformed into a journey of purpose to support, review, and promote Ladakh culture. Holding the hands of Academy of Art, Culture, and Language, I traveled extensively into the valley and mountains of my land to perform before my people. Everyone welcomed, appreciated, and encouraged me. I got the opportunity to work with the seniors in the field of art and music, who blessed by sharing their knowledge and experience in song, dance, music, tales, tradition, custom, etc. Gathering the wisdom of those great people, I and my friends thought of organizing plays. This led to creation of Lamdon Dramatic Club, which became popular and people started identifying with it and its work. We not only carried out repairs and cleaning of religious and cultural sites, but also used the platform for awareness, building and mobilization of village communities on social issues against voluntary, in favor of women's right to inherit property, against animal sacrifice, for enrollment of children in school and of young youth in army. Those proved to be important contribution towards removal of people interest in religion and nation building. Lamdon Club expanded to become a society, and we also opened a school of which I was the first teacher. Around this time came the All India Radio Leh, and my dream come true. Songs lingering on my mind and heart got a means to reach out to the people. Then I started on to get married. I wanted to get my three daughters well educated, but could not do justice to them in my pursuit of, in my interest in serving the society and its rich culture. But I have no complaint. Even for the blames that were thrown at me at time, as they say, if you stand firm on the path of truth, others will be kind to you, sooner or later. Also, if you do good to the society, your good will be taken care of. I consider myself lucky, so lucky that I don't have a great wish to go to Devachan paradise after I have had all this chance to stand up before His Holiness the Dalai Lama and speak as in when he visited Ladakh. What other privilege can I dream after His Holiness called me a friend? His Holiness appreciates the Himalayan region for its richness of folk song and always advise us to protect our culture. Why do we ignore all this then? Why do we disregard our culture when it is precious for the whole world, so much so that people take great pains to get a glimpse of it? There are at least 1600 songs in Ladakhi culture. How many of these are in use now? In past 4 decades, things changed enormously. Had it all not happened before my eyes, it was hard to believe. I saw houses changing their shapes 3 times. Barley fields were converted into sites for hotels. Groundwater got lifted to the field, to the third floor. Local toilets got washed away with water, while irrigation channels got dashed to the ground. The little bazaar of Leh expanded to Tyarerong and Abichen Methang. Our children and grandchildren find it difficult to recognize customs and ornaments worn by us and our parents. Ceremonies like Losar, Shubla, marriage, Ista become very short into rising of a few slogans. Seasonal celebration considering agriculture practice are breathing their last in the noise of tractors, threshers, and dish TV. In the rush of tourists, locals find difficult to ask each other welfare. What is left in all this hustle and bustle is the minuscule group of people like me who are doing what they can in reviving and showcasing various aspects of Ladakhi cultures and keep its heritage alive, but for how long? There are many Ladakhis who have witnessed the ups and downs of post-independence era, and I am one of them. To illustrate the extent of this change, let me pick up some examples. Just 50 years ago, matchbox were luxury, and my mother used to go to neighbor house to get pieces of cowed up ashes in order to get fire for cooking. Up until the age of 8 or 9, I used to walk without a pair of shoes or trousers. It was normal for children to keep private parts of their bodies exposed without any sense of shame. Now, the moment a child is born, several sets of socks and trousers are ready alongside huggies to cover his or body. Mother used to keep their breasts uncovered so that while they make bread, children take turns to soaking her milk without disturbing her in her task. A significant number of customs and practices have already disappeared. Kesar tails, so-so, mentok cheek, Malalatse, Riguchung, Marme, and so on. Ladakhi songs are a wealth of information on its past. These songs describe Ladakh society at various stages of its evolution. For example, a large number of songs starting with pairs of Nyati Tanpo date back to the period of Ladakhi first kings killing Yimagon and Lachanpa Yugon. Several songs come to Ladakh along with Ryal Khatun. Apocho Dreams became a song before Singhi Namgyal was born. Nyima Namgyal time was the golden period for songs. The complete story of Leh Palace is contained in the song entitled Lechen Skumkar. Morup Tanzin and Salam Khatun episode stands narrated as a song. Deskyung Namgyal in Nilza Amo's tragedy describes Chun Song Tunruk, the evil colon of Basgo, and other such vital parts of Ladakh, past and described in songs. While the popular song, Dakhlas Kespe Lemento, expressed the feeling of Kalakashi, the colon of Ayu, Nomo Angwale narrated the interface between Shunu Tunduk, Sopa Kunsop, and Sanskar women. And Skara Lil Barma expressed feeling of Ama Sonam and Skobdan Shahara, penned down by Ghulam Muhammad Devajan. Ghazals are introduced by Sipa Razak. Then there are songs of prayers to the motherland composed by Kalam Rasul while hurling prayers flag at the Great Wall of China. However, gone are the days when before a marriage, stars were consulted. The modern marriage are sudden, quick, and short-lived. No wonder the auspicious nature of marriage is past disappearing. When the grandfather asked for the song, what the gets in Urdu song, what they repair kaham. Similarly, a request for a dance is responsive with the jisko. Is there anyone left who know the dance snemarses? Who has the time to sing and dance as per tradition? Such a disregard to the culture did not occur even when King Loto Chokhan snatched the throne from Lachen Bhavan, or when Mirza Haider invaded the kingdom of Gyalpo Tashi Namgyal, or when Ragazan Sevang threatened the rule of Lalex Namgyal, or when King Opat Namad became a Muslim. Between 1740 and 1750 AD, Queen Putir Wangmo became a ruler of Ladakh, but there were no harm done to the culture. Deskyung diverse Nilza Angmo but did not open traditions. The region came under the Rogras for 113 years, but by and large, the culture and tradition remained intact. But the change that come their independence, particularly after 1970s, some like a tsunami. It uprooted almost everything as the dance of progress and development continued unabated, leaving everyone confused, tired, and lost. In the middle of all these, you may find some relatively luckier pockets who still hold on to their culture, but for how long? So what happens now? While the people are losing their grip of their culture, then the task of preserving the rich treasure of our past has fallen on the archives and libraries of institutions like AIR, Doordarshan, and Culture Academy. Can they do so? We have the example of fire at AIRLeh, which took away a large part of our valuable collection of songs and other cultural assets. Can someone like MorupNamgyal with his gold medal and Padma Shri protect this heritage? And how long will they survive? Our occasional words of appreciation to Sri Tanzin and other experts during function or seminars serve the purpose. Rinchen Tunduk, Prince of Sering, Sishu Lamo, and Mama Shafi really made valuable contribution to Ladakh culture, but they are not more, no more. How many peoples may have Meme Iba, Abagulu, Nima Sering, Agubutu, our expert in Surna and Daman, left behind? Are our culture resources not melting down like glaciers of mighty Himalaya. Ladakh has been sitting comfortably in the lap of Himalayas, but where are those Ladakhis? Are we not? Though our action in the few decades of progress on the verge of destroying the tradition of centuries. More recently, I saw something I did not bestow. I witnessed the 100-year-old bazaar, a repository of Ladakhi past with the memories of so many of us, getting brutally plundered and murdered in the name of progress and development. When asked, I was told that the Leh bazaar is being beautified. It is going to have a new and modern look. It is going to be a model town. I was speechless. Has the Leh bazaar lost its opportunity to continue as a symbol of the heritage town of Ladakh that is one used to be? Can someone reassure me that while change has to be welcome, we are stepping into the new age with our living behind the values and sign of our rich cultural heritage? Thank you very much.